Well, Bob, since our first Jesuit Agenda video, we've established quite a friendship.
That's right.
I've just come to treasure your friendship and what your ministry is doing, Biblical Studies Institute there in Hermosa, South Dakota. We're together once again.
That's right.
And this is not a Jesuit Agenda video, though. This is something a little bit different. And this title, The Military Takeover of America. What a startling title, Bob. You know, we've known it was going to happen, but to see it happening and how that everything is being prepared is mind-boggling. And
that's
you've
right.
just told me a little bit, and I know there's much, much more as we spend this time together today and with those that are at home watching on this video. Bob, I think that, of course, we should start with prayer.
That's right.
But I think after the prayer that maybe we should... have a little music.
Fine.
To kind of prepare us
right.
and our viewers because of the intensity of this video. So why don't you have a word of prayer?
Certainly.
And Ralph and I will sing a number, and then we'll get right to the heart of the matter.
Okay.
Gracious Father in heaven, how thankful we are to Thee for the message of the Word of God, for the word about the kingdom that Jesus brought to us in His life here on this earth, revealed to us in the Bible. Lord, we thank You that our kingdom with Thee, Thy kingdom here, is not of this world, but that it is oriented to the eternal world,
Amen.
To heaven and to the new earth, that we have the prospect to look forward to of a life in eternity with Thee, that whatever horrors may develop in this world in the final events of the clash of the great controversy before Your second coming, that we can be sustained by the fact that we belong to a different kingdom than the kingdoms of this world.
Amen.
That our mission is to call people out of this world, out of Babylon, to the principles and within the security and safety of Your kingdom. And Lord, today as we examine the signs of the times that are rapidly, with lightning speed, fulfilling around us, as we delve into the developments of the marshaling of the nations, which we are called upon to examine by the Spirit of prophecy, and as we examine the drive for the New World Order spoken about in Revelation 17 and 13. We pray that we will ever keep our hearts uplifted to Thee, that we will realize that we can live on the high places of this earth because we have learned the message of Your Sabbath, Your
Amen.
Law of God, and that we can live above the developments that are taking place and sit in heavenly places with Thee. Thank You so much for Prophecy Countdown and for John Diane's faithful ministry in this place, and that we can be together again discussing the matters of the kingdom once again with Thy people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Well, Bob, as I said, because of the intensity of this video, I think it'd be well for all if we just sit back for a few moments and listen to some soothing music to prepare our hearts for this special video.
That's right.
Move it. There is
Well, I hope that you enjoyed that.
Sure did.
Well, Bob, where do we begin?
Well, John, I would like to begin first with a few words of inspiration about the kingdom of God.
Amen.
As we at the ministry have been examining the signs of the times, it has been so appalling to us that I have had a dynamic tension going on in my soul and in my heart and in my mind, because on the one hand, we see the diabolical developments that are taking place and the reality of those and the documentation of that, the pinpointing accuracy of the things that are happening. And on the other hand, there's a call, a sweet call of the Spirit of God, that we can live above that and we can be part of the kingdom of God and we can live in the domain of the security of the kingdom. And so I'd like to just bring a few texts of Scripture here as we begin. Matthew chapter 10, for example, where Jesus sends out the disciples and he's warning them about the things that they're going to face. Now we, John, in our nation here in America, we have had such a long time of peace and security and good police officers and good laws and
yes.
Bill of Rights and Constitution, but all this is going to rapidly change.
It is changing.
We see the window of opportunity is present now like never before for the New World Order people. We have a Jesuit-trained president. In fact, this video builds on all the four previous videos that we've done. Those are a prelude. We have been examining step by step now for the last couple of years in these videos the philosophical preparation for the New World Order, the religious preparation for the New World Order, the mind conditioning that's been going on. Now we're going to look at the teeth coming out. And we have had decided and incisive developments in this nation that give us a warning. They're like straws in the wind of the storm that is coming. And there are thousands of people out there who are not Adventists, but who are keenly interested in the great controversy suddenly because they see that it is describing the events that are taking place.
Amen.
And this is a most heartening development.
Yes.
I tell you, you know, Ellen White said this, that things were going to go like fire in the stubble. Well, suddenly, as a result actually of our researcher, Craig Meisner, the fax networks that are spreading word and warnings about the threats to the Constitution are suddenly carrying the Great Controversy.
Amen.
And ads for the Great Controversy.
Amen.
So people can get them. Police organizations that are warning the police not to turn on the people, but to stand by the Constitution and stand by the people of America, are quoting from the Great Controversy. And we'll look at that in a bit.
Unbelievable.
But there is a great struggle coming here in America, and we want to hear the word of what Jesus told the disciples. Because, you know, in Jesus' day, they had a world empire that they were in subjection to.
Romans.
The Romans, and the Romans were fierce warriors, and the Jews hated the Romans. They wanted national sovereignty, and at times there would be outbreaks, and the Romans would come in and just crush them and massacre them. And, of course, Masada was a climax to this, and the fall of Jerusalem. But even in Jesus' day, there were these outbreaks, and the zealot, Simon the Zealot, was one of the disciples of Jesus. Every zealot carried a dagger in his pocket under his robes, ready at a moment's notice to have rebellion against the Romans. And the Romans were aware of this, so there was a lot of this kind of tension. And Jesus lived in that environment, and he never called upon the people to have a carnal, physical force revolution against the Romans.
That's
because
right.
He knew that freedom came, first of all, from God, the Holy Spirit, and deliverance from sin.
Amen.
If the Jews had understood the message of the gospel about victory over sin, there would never have been a Roman standard waving over Jerusalem, Ellen White says.
Isn't that something?
Jerusalem would have stood forever, and it would have been a whole different picture. But they fell into the love of sin rather than the love of the law of God in truth. Though they professed love for the law of God, in reality they loved sin and hated righteousness and crucified the Lord of glory.
That's right.
But here is what Jesus said to the disciples, the 12, when he sent them out. He said, "Go not into the way of the Gentiles," and this is Matthew chapter 10, verse 5. "Go not into the way of the Gentiles and into any city of the Samaritans, enter ye not, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And as ye go, preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand." So the kingdom of God is, the kingdom of heaven is a spiritual kingdom, And our work in the Holocaust that is coming upon the earth is to bring people the three angels' messages, of course. And the weapons of our warfare we must make very clear at the beginning of this, because we're going to be dealing with some very sensitive issues. The weapons of our warfare, Paul says, are not carnal, but they are spiritual.
Amen.
And mighty through God for the tearing down of strongholds. So the spiritual weapons are more powerful than the carnal weapons. And we have some very precious promises I want to read in just a moment about this. But Jesus said, "Behold, I send you forth as sheep in the midst of wolves. Be ye therefore wise as serpents and harmless as doves. But beware of men, for they will deliver you up to the councils, and they will scourge you in their synagogues, and ye shall be brought before governors and kings for my sake, for a testimony against them and the Gentiles." And what begins as a war, as a battle over the Constitution, will eventually wind up in the great confrontation between the three angels' messages and all the arrayed forces of evil against them. Coming down here, Jesus said, "The brother shall deliver up the brother to death, and the father the child, and the child shall rise up against their parents and cause them to be put to death. And ye shall be hated of all men for my name's sake. But he that endureth to the end shall be saved. But when they persecute you in this city, flee ye into another. For verily I say unto you, ye shall not have gone over the cities of Israel till the Son of Man be come. The disciple is not above his master, nor the servant above his Lord. It is enough for the disciple that he be as his master, and the servant as his Lord. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebub, how much more shall they call them of his household?" And I think all of the things that we are going through now are a preparation, a basic training for the days to come, where we will have the very things that Jesus was accused of being thrown at us. "Fear not them, therefore, for there is nothing covered that shall not be revealed, and hid that shall not be known. What I tell you in darkness, that speak ye in light, and what ye hear in the ear, that preach ye upon the housetops. And fear not them which kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul." So the protection of Jesus is protection for eternity. We may be called upon to be martyrs, which in Greek means the one who gives a testimony, sealing our testimony with our blood. But in God's plan, our eternal life is secure if our will is surrendered to Him. And in the days to come, we are going to need to have such a close connection with Christ that we will have direction from Him about what to do as the crisis unfolds and as it develops. "Fear not them which kill the body, but are not able to kill the soul, but rather fear Him which is able to destroy both soul and body in hell." And then Jesus speaks about confessing Him and not denying Him. I would like to bring a couple other quotations here as we begin. And one is from Isaiah chapter 26, where Jesus, through the prophet Isaiah, the gospel prophet, gives a most wonderful welcome and invitation. Verse 20 of Isaiah 26, "Come, my people, enter thou into thy chambers and shut thy doors about thee. Hide thyself, as it were, for a little moment until the indignation be overpassed." And commenting on this, Ellen White tells us, "When tempted to sin, let us remember that Jesus is pleading for us in the heavenly sanctuary. When we put away our sins and come to Him in faith, He takes our names on His lips and presents them to His Father, saying, 'I have graven them upon the palms of my hands. I know them by name.' And the command goes forth to the angels to protect them." John, one time I opened up my CD-ROM and I began looking at the subject of angelic protection at the end of time. And over and over again, Ellen White assures us of angelic protection.
Amen.
But it's only to those who have overcome sin. That's an important point. And that's where all of this talk about historic Adventism has been so important. "Then in the day of fierce trial, He will say, 'Come, my people, enter thou into thy chambers and shut thy doors about thee. Hide thyself, as it were, for a little moment until the indignation be overpassed.' What are the chambers in which they are to hide? They are the protection of Christ and His holy angels. The people of God are not at this time all in one place. They are in different companies, and in all parts of the earth, and they will be tried singly, not in groups. Everyone must stand the test for himself. And so there we have the protection that is offered to the faithful. Now, we have in the spirit of prophecy some warnings about what is coming. We have, first of all, in Great Controversy, a warning about what is coming to America. God's Word has given warning of the impending danger. Let this be unheeded, and the Protestant world will learn what the purposes of Rome really are only when it is too late to escape the snare. What is the attitude of the Protestant world toward Rome now?
Oh, they're making apologies for the way they've acted in the past, and that she's one of their Christian brothers and sisters, you know, and that we must all come together in ecumenicalism.
See, the machinery is being set up now for control.
Absolutely.
When I look at this healthcare plan, I know if my father was still alive, he was a physician, he would have been appalled at this, because it means the end of private practice. Every point of contact where you go for medical treatment, if this plan goes into effect, will be a contact with the New World Order, where you will be given forms from the government to fill out every detail of your life, be put into the computer, your life will be monitored as never before. She is silently growing into power. Her doctrines are exerting their influence in legislative halls, in the churches, and in the hearts of men. We've been examining this in the last number of videos. She is piling up her lofty and massive structures in the secret recesses of which her former persecutions will be repeated. Stealthily and unsuspectedly, she is strengthening her forces to further her own ends when the time shall come for her to strike. And it has been said of the agencies that are at work now in the United States and in the world, that they are making haste slowly, but when the time comes for them to strike, they will strike with great terror. And we saw this in the WACO
Absolutely. Incident. I couldn't help but think of that when you were saying that.
All that she desires is vantage ground, and this is already being given her. We shall soon see and shall feel what the purpose of the Roman element is. Whoever shall believe and obey the word of God will thereby incur reproach and persecution. Now, I have a few other quotes here regarding the overwhelming surprise which is coming upon this nation. The work of the people of God is to prepare for the events of the future, which will soon come upon them with blinding force. Blinding force. The life that we're living now, the day-to-day existence which people have settled into and find their comfort zone in, will suddenly be changed and altered. It will come with blinding force.
Instantly, overnight.
Instantly. In the world, gigantic monopolies will be formed. Men will bind themselves together in unions that will wrap them in the folds of the enemy. A few men will combine to grasp all the means to be obtained in certain lines of business. We're seeing the mergers, the hostile takeovers now. Trades unions will be formed, and those who refuse to join these unions will be marked men. Now that's Country Living, page 10. You will need much of the rich grace of the Savior and a deep, settled conviction that the work of the people of God is to prepare for the events of the future, which will soon come upon them with blinding force. That's Fourth Manuscript Release, page 74. Confusion fills the world, and a great terror is soon to come upon human beings. The end is very near. God's people should be preparing for what is to break upon the world as an overwhelming surprise. Well, that just gives us a little sample.
There are many.
There are many, many, and many there that I have that I didn't read.
Yeah.
Now, John, as I was studying the things that we're going to be looking at in this video, I found a quotation that nerved me to expose my heart to the things that we're going to be looking at, because I was having difficulty for a number of days studying some of these things. They were so horrific.
Just a few of the things that you've told me, Bob. We really have not gone through this. This has not been prepared. You're the one that's done the preparation. But Friday and in the sermon yesterday at the Rolling Hills Church, you just touched upon some things you're going to be dealing with this video, and it's just overwhelming. And that's why I'm just so conscious that our people have to really pray that the Holy Spirit will prepare them for the intensity of this video and what you have to show us today.
Here's the quote that nerved me when I was in my spiritual study in the morning. I read this from 12th Manuscript Release, page 42. God calls for men and means. Those who cannot see the signs of the times in this wicked and adulterous generation will be found with those who perish under the plagues poured from the vials of God's wrath.
Wow.
So we have to understand the signs of the times.
Yes, have to.
As difficult as it may be.
It's life or death.
The easy way is to stick your head in the sand, you know, and to say, look, you know, I'd rather not expose myself to that. I'd rather just do my daily thing and not pay attention to it.
I don't have to tell you this, Bob. You know the horse laughs that we're getting from a lot of people because they're worried about the Jesuits and they're just throwing dust in the air and getting everybody all shook up. Just get back to sleep, mainly is what the structure is telling the people. I'm telling you, Bob, that when you read and study, it becomes very clear that those who are ignorant of the signs of the times and are not keeping on top of breaking events are going to be lost.
That's right.
It's a life or death issue.
We will perish under the plagues.
Absolutely.
This one is from 5th Manuscript Release, page 305, and it regards Ellen White's statement regarding civil war. In India, China, Russia, and the cities of America, thousands of men and women are dying of starvation. The moneyed men, because they have the power, control the market. They purchase at low rates all they can obtain and then sell at greatly increased prices. This means starvation to the poorer classes and will result in a civil war. There will be a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation. We know now that...
Where was that from?
This is from 5 Manuscript Release, page 305.
Okay.
And we know now that we found out that about 95% of the food production and distribution in America is controlled by just a few people. And this will be the ultimate tool of control in the New World Order.
Oh, food, absolutely.
Food. If the people can't get food, they get desperate.
Bottom line.
Okay, John. Well, I would like to... introduce our material here perhaps with a little overview, which I mentioned yesterday, and that is we love America. We love America. I love America.
Amen. I'm a patriot.
You said when you came back from Russia you were ready to kiss the ground.
Kiss the ground.
And you were singing,
God bless America.
I love the Bill of Rights.
Amen.
And I love the Constitution. I love freedom. I love what this nation has stood for. And I want people to understand that very clearly as we go into this video. We also appreciate the police protection that are functioning within the bounds of just and righteous and good laws.
Romans 13 makes that very plain.
However, there is something that happens when a government becomes corrupt. And we are watching now the corruption of our government proceeding on a grand scale. Lesbians being appointed to high office. Homosexuals being welcomed right into the White House within a day of the inauguration. The drive to bring the homosexuals into the military. And right now, AIDS is the primary killer, the first killer between ages 25 and 44.
Men.
Of men, right, in this nation. And when a government becomes evil and espouses an occultic philosophy or Catholic principles, it begins making laws that are evil.
Yes.
And then the police are faced with a crisis. Who shall they support, the system or the people? And then there is turmoil in society, and what we see as a trial run for all of this in the Nazi movement, we see what happened when the police force was nationalized. And we're going to be going into that in some detail today. The Gestapo was basically the nationalization of the police force in Germany. And I'm sure that the people of Germany, when there were many good people. The moral fabric at that time on Earth was much stronger than it is now as we approach the end of this century. But I think the rank and file German people had no idea what was coming upon them with Hitler. They had an opportunity of reading Mein Kampf, of seeing what his plan was. But it didn't really fully dawn on them, the full impact of it all, even until after the war.
We were over in Germany just recently, and my wife and I talked with some of the German people who went through that time, and almost all of them said virtually the same thing, that they were just going with the tide.
Yes.
It was such an overwhelming surge of camaraderie and patriotism, and it just seemed the right thing to do because you were just caught up in this tidal wave of nationality, you know?
Yeah, the nationalism. After they had been so humiliated after World War I, I have talked to some Germans who lived during this time, and they said there was no stealing. The party, the bond of the Nazi party called for no stealing. You could leave your bicycle by the side of the road and it would be there days later. You could come back and pick it up. They had a program where the workers went on vacations. They had never had this before. Hitler gave them things. Gave them the Autobahn, developed the Volkswagen, you know, wagon for the folk. Mm-hmm. And gave them so many things that when the hour came for him to call on them to serve in the military and to do his bidding, they felt they were under obligation to do
that. Isn't that something?
It was a great psychological maneuver that went on. And the people were tired of turmoil. There was fighting in the streets. They wanted security. They wanted freedom from starvation. They wanted, and what do we hear now? Security, security. Every American deserves to be secure. But to get it, you trade in your liberty and your freedom and independence from the government to be on the government
dole. It's a trade-off.
It's a trade-off.
Sure.
And William Shearer, who is an American correspondent, went to the Germans as he saw these things happening. He said, doesn't it concern you that you're losing your freedom here, freedom of the press, you're losing your freedom of religion, you're losing all of these freedoms? And they said, well, that's inconsequential.
It's
we're
worth
at least
it.
Free from starvation.
That's right. It's
we
worth
have
it.
Economic security. And yeah. So you see, this is what we are being hit with over and over again. Now, I have here a book by Jerry Spence. And Jerry Spence we're going to be talking about a little bit more later, but I want to use this as an introduction. It's entitled From Freedom to Slavery. He is the attorney that defended Randy Weaver in the Randy Weaver trial, which we're going to be explaining a little bit more about later. And he has won more multi-million dollar decisions, jury decisions, than any other man living on the face of this planet. In a recent court case, his own fees were $50 million. Hmm. He defended Randy Weaver free of charge and contributed $100,000 to the defense because he saw a principle at stake. And here's what he says in this book, From Freedom to Slavery. In this country, we embrace the myth that we are still a democracy. This is page 5. When we know that we are not a democracy, that we are not free, that the government does not serve us but subjugates us. Although we give lip service to the notion of freedom, we know that the government is no longer the servant of the people, but at last has become the people's master. We have stood by like timid sheep while the wolf killed first the weak, then the strays, then those on the outer edges of the flock, until at last the entire flock belonged to the wolf. We did not care about the weak or about the strays, Branch Davidians or whatever. They were not part of the flock. They were not part of the ecumenical movement. We did not care about those on the outer edges, Randy Weaver. They had chosen to be there. But as the wolf worked its way toward the center of the flock, we discovered that we were now on the outer edges. Now we must look the wolf squarely in the eye, that we did not do so when the first of us was ripped
yes.
and torn and eaten was the
yes.
first wrong,
yes.
and it was our wrong.
That's right.
So today we want to examine some of the beginning of the speaking as a dragon mm-hmm. of the beast of Revelation 13.
Amen.
John, in Germany, there were a number of pastors that saw what was happening to the German people.
Pastors?
Pastors.
Mm.
Pastors such as Dietrich Bonhoeffer and Martin Niemöller.
What did they do about it?
Well, Martin Niemöller started a movement called the Confessional Church. See, Hitler tried to get all of the churches together and under the control of the government.
Sure.
You see, and that's what's going to happen here.
Sure.
That is what is in the process of happening right now.
Tell me about it.
including our own structure.
No.
And this Martin Niemöller was eventually sent to the Dachau concentration camp in 1938. I was in the Dachau concentration camp. I saw the gas chambers. I walked through them. I saw the horrific pictures. He was sent there because of standing up for his conscience.
Yep.
These men were thoroughgoing analysts of what Hitler was doing and where he was taking the people. It wasn't that some Germans were not apprehensive. There was quite a resistance movement. But by and large, the bulk of the people allowed themselves to be corralled into this thing and went along with it. They were hypnotized, as it were. But here is what a famous quotation that Martin Niemöller said, which we have to pay attention to. In Germany, the Nazis first came for the communists, and I didn't speak up because I wasn't a communist. Now, there are many people who didn't speak up on behalf of the Branch Davidians. They said, well, these people are a cult. They listened to what the media said. Incidentally, the media was under the control of Hitler.
Absolutely.
In Germany. The media here, we have already demonstrated in our other videos, is under the control of the CFR, the TC, the Trilateral Commission, and the New World Order people.
We're finding out that all this stuff that the media was feeding the populace about David Koresh was a lie.
Well, just a second,
absolutely,
let me get something here.
Absolutely a lie. He never equated himself to God. He didn't say he was the Messiah. He wasn't sleeping with all these different women in his commune. They weren't beating the children. I mean, all of this stuff was a lie, an unbelievable lie.
Here I have USA Today, and this is October 1 to 3, 1993. ATF lied about WACO raid.
Look at that right there on the headlines. USA Today, ATF lied about WACO raid. Unbelievable.
Headlines. So it's not just us that's saying it.
Yeah, well, it's
nor Tex Mars alone. In Germany, the Nazis first came for the communists, and I didn't speak up because I wasn't a communist. Then they came for the Jews, and I didn't speak up because I wasn't a Jew. All these groups, these fringe groups that Jerry Spence is talking about here. Then they came for the trade unionists, and I didn't speak up because I wasn't a trade unionist. Then they came for the Catholic, and I didn't speak up because I was a Protestant. Finally, they came for me, but there was no one left to speak up.
Oh.
And so we have to draw the line, John, and we have to say what needs to be said about what is happening in America today. Now, I want to just give a very brief sketch of an overview that will recap from a different perspective the developments that we have looked at in the preceding four videos. And that is that in 1776, our Declaration of Independence was signed, but there was another important development that took place in 1776, and that was the formation of the Illuminati. They were formed by a Jesuit who renounced his oath. He was a professor at Ingolstadt University, and he formed the Illuminati, which were going to then push for a new world order. And on our $1 bill on the backside, we have already looked at this, but there's something I want to draw our attention to here. There you see the pyramid and the all-seeing eye and Novus Ordo Seclorum, which we have spoken about. But at the base of the pyramid is a series of Roman numerals that adds up to 1776. It's very hard to read because it's so small. It adds up to 1776.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we look back on Independence Day to 1776 and we say this was the date when we declared our independence as a nation from Great Britain.
July 4.
July 4. Yes, my son was born on July 4. And so the question that has to be asked here, though, is in this setting, with the words in Latin for a new world order, with the pyramid, the occult, with the occult all-seeing eye, and the number 1776 on the pyramid, at the base of the pyramid, in this setting, which 1776 is this talking about?
I mean,
it's talking about the New World Order. New World Order, the founding of the Illuminati.
Oh,
you see what I'm saying? In this setting, with the New World Order underneath it, and the occultic pyramid, and the occultic all-seeing
eye. So the 1776 is not a patriotic thing for the Declaration of Independence for America. It's for the founding of the New World Order.
In that context, it's talking about the founding of the New World Order, the founding for the drive. So what we have found here happening in America is, on the one hand, we have this glorious event of the founding of our nation, and then in 1787, the framing of our Constitution, 1791, the ratification of our Bill of Rights, which formed the cradle for Adventism to be born in. 25 years later, William Miller starts studying his Bible from beginning to end and comes across Daniel 8:14. It ultimately became known to refer to October 22, 1844.
Sure.
But the Advent movement was born in this cradle, and this was God's plan. His hope was that this whole nation would become a missionary nation, you know, that it would accept these three angels' messages and be a light to the whole world. So you have this impetus toward truth and toward liberty, toward the Holy Spirit, toward the three angels' messages. On the other hand, you have, at the same year of our Declaration of Independence, the beginning by Satan of something that was going to contest this movement of the three angels' messages.
Yes.
The founding of the Illuminati by an ex-Jesuit who once again assumed his oath as a Jesuit just before his death. He just laid it aside long enough to found the Illuminati. And we know from our study that the Illuminati got the Masons involved. And Roman Catholicism uses many fronts, many front organizations. This would be expected by an organization trying to take over the world. Now, what we have traced in our other videos is developments toward the New World Order in many areas of human life and existence. But I want to draw our attention now to some very interesting things that happen on the devil's side of this battle as opposed to the three angels' messages. And that is that Karl Marx took many of his ideas of international revolution from the Illuminatis. And he developed Marxism, which was then espoused by the Bolsheviks, by the Russians in the Bolshevik Revolution. And we have a very prominent American citizen named Zbigniew Zbrinsky. And here is his book, Between Two Ages, America's Role in the Technotronic
Era. He was in the Carter administration,
wasn't he? Yes, he was National Security Advisor for Carter. And in this book, he lauds Marxism, pure Marxism, as a great advance for humanity. It took humanity out of the nationalist, the closed nationalist mentality, and it introduced the idea of revolution on an international scale. He is obviously a committed and dedicated pure Marxist. Now, this man would go on to found in our nation the Federal Emergency Management Agency. And I want to get something about that right now.
You know what you were saying, Bob, about the devil bringing up something in 1776, just like America, that was his organization that was being formed when God was forming his organization of freedom, is exactly the situation that took place with our church. You know, when our church came into existence in the mid-1800s, we have Jehovah's Witness, we have Mormons, we have false prophets, Mary Baker Eddy with Christian Science. You know, we have all of these counterfeits coming up around the genuine, that Satan is starting up around the genuine that God is starting up. And this holds true to what you just said, that when God was bringing America as the land of the free and the home of the brave up, Satan was bringing a counterfeit organization, the Illuminati, up around it that started at the same time. And the 1776 that we see at the bottom of the pyramid on the back of our dollar bill is not for the formation of the Declaration of Independence, but for the formation of the Illuminati. It fits Satan's practice, exactly what he does.
And see, this is this kind of doublespeak that
we're
encountering everywhere. Now, it's interesting, in his book here, Zbigniew Zbrinsky tells of how an encyclical was issued by the Pope, which basically was in harmony with Marxist ideology. And he says here that in the West, most non-socialist parties now accept the welfare society as desirable and normal, though not necessarily requiring extensive nationalization. The Catholic Church expressed much the same point of view in the remarkable papal encyclical Mater et Magistra in 1961. That's just before Vatican II. This is page 79 and 80 of Between Two Ages, America's Role in the Technotronic Era. So what he is saying is that the ideas of Marxism have spread all across the Western world. Here is another statement on page 75. Given the dominant role of the activist West in shaping the outlook of our times, now in the second half of the 20th century, almost everyone, often without knowing it, is to some extent a Christian, a nationalist, and a Marxist. Mm. So he's saying that Marxist ideologies have penetrated all through Christianity. Yeah. Now, here's a sample of his statement about Marxism. Marxism, its revolutionary and broadening influence, this is page 74, which opened man's mind to previously ignored perspectives and dramatized previously neglected concerns. And he does regret that there was an enslaving dimension to it in the Soviet Union, but on page 73,
well, that's nice of him.
So page 73, he says, in this sense, Marxism has served as a mechanism of human progress. Backing up to page 72 to give you a little context. That is why Marxism represents a further vital and creative stage in the maturing of man's universal vision. Marxism is simultaneously a victory of the external active man over the inner passive man and a victory of reason over belief. It stresses man's capacity to shape his material destiny, finite and defined as man's only reality, and it postulates the absolute capacity of man to truly understand his reality as a point of departure for his active endeavors to shape it.
This is absolutely incredible that these words are coming out and in print from a man who was a cabinet member in the Carter administration.
National Security Advisor.
National Security Advisor, and he's a Marxist.
And he wrote this book, John, back in 1970. It's copyrighted. When the Cold War was still going on.
Unbelievable. Before he ever came into office.
And he was a Marxist. Now listen to this stunning statement on page 73. Because of this, Marxism appealed simultaneously to man's ethical, rational, and Promethean instincts. The ethical component sustained by man's emotions drew on the Judeo-Christian heritage. The rational responded to man's increased desire to comprehend the dynamic of his material environment more systematically. And the Promethean stood for man's faith in his powers, for the notion that history is made by the people and that nothing can hem in their advance to perfection. In this sense, Marxism has served as a mechanism of human progress, even if its practice has often fallen short of its ideals. Teilhard de Chardin notes at one point, and you know about him.
Oh, yeah.
He's the Jesuit who is the primary influence in the New Age movement. Notes at one point that monstrous as it is not modern totalitarianism really the distortion of something magnificent and thus quite near to the truth? Modern totalitarianism being something very near to the truth.
Unbelievable.
And here he quotes Teilhard as a favorable quotation. It has been Marxism that has served to stir the mind and mobilize human energies purposefully. Marxism has decisively contributed to the political institutionalization and systematization of the deliberate effort to define the nature of our era and of man's relationship to history at any given stage in that history. Now, to set these statements in perspective a little bit, John, we have the Bolshevik Revolution taking place in 1917.
Right.
Lenin was put on a sealed train that ran from Switzerland through Germany and into Russia. He was financed with $20 million by the Western agencies. What was going on? And we have touched a little bit on this in other Jesuit Agenda videos, but there is much material coming out now indicating that there was a desire of the secret societies to set up a counterpoise to the United States. So you have here the vast Soviet Union, one-sixth of the Earth's surface, which would now espouse Marxism, which was a creation of the Illuminati, which was headed by a Jesuit, professor of canon law at Ingolstadt University. A nation that would serve as a counterpoise to the United States.
And it did for many
and
years.
And Rome, what nation has Rome wanted to subjugate more than any other?
Russia.
The United States of America. And you can read all about it in books by Charles Shinnecke the priest, 50 Years in the Church of Rome. The Conspiracy Against the Liberties of the United States is another book that deals with this. The Civil War, we now know, even a conservative Catholic author now has come out and said that that was a religious war. There are things that have gone on behind the surface, John, that are absolutely astounding. But here we have a nation now that would accept the principles of Marxism, that would be a counterpoise to the United States, that would be a revolutionary entity that would want to extend its revolution of Marxism over the entire world,
yes.
That sets up a magnificent counterintelligence agency, the KGB, ultimately known to be the KGB, originally the Cheka. And this entity is resting upon Marxism, which ultimately rests upon a Jesuit's concepts. Now, here you have evidence that Zbigniew Brzezinski, who is the national security advisor under Carter, espoused these principles in 1970. We have already studied, John, and I want to get a book here. The keys
what time
of this
did Carter, what year did Carter come into office?
I forget which one it was, maybe.
76?
76. Keys of this blood, we've often referred to, has a whole chapter on Gramsciism, and Antonio Gramsci we have talked about in other videos, but I want to bring him in here because the KGB ultimately accepted his idea of the destruction of Christianity, the destruction of faith in Christianity to pave the way for communistic principles. Now, Zbigniew Brzezinski says that the encyclical in 1961 was in harmony with Marxist principles, a papal encyclical. In the Vatican II Council from 62 to 65, they accept Gramsciism. The major orders of the Catholic Church, the Jesuits, the Mary Knollers, the Franciscans, the Dominicans, all accept, by and large, they accept Gramsci's principles, and they become, according to Malachy Martin, the midwife and wet nurse to introduce this into our society. Now we have come to a president that is Jesuit trained who is introducing Gramsci-style socialism on a grand and massive scale
quickly
here in America.
Unbelievable how quick he is doing this.
Now, to tie this together a little bit more, Zbigniew Brzezinski is the one who created FEMA, a secret government. I have here a document by Harry Martin, and Harry Martin, let me just get another document over here to give you a little of his credentials. Harry Martin is the editor of the Napa Sentinel. Okay, John, I have here a book that has just come out. In fact, I picked it up here in Orlando. It's entitled Kiss the Boys Goodbye, How the United States Betrayed Its Own POWs in Vietnam, by Monica Jensen Stevenson and William Stevenson. To give you just a brief survey of what is in this book, I'll read something off the back cover. In this shocking expose, two award-winning journalists provide startling evidence that American government officials, right up to the highest echelons, know and have always known that American POWs were left behind at the end of the war. More amazingly, they allege that these officials have regularly obstructed the efforts of private citizens to discover the truth. Out of a world of secret information, anonymous sources, official obstruction, missing files, and censored testimony, the authors of Kiss the Boys Goodbye bring us eye-opening revelations about the government's abuse of power and secrecy. Not only does the book reveal evidence of men abandoned and families torn apart, but it raises larger questions that strike at the very heart of democracy. Reading this explosive book will forever change the way you view the Vietnam War, the Americans who fought in it, and the government that betrayed them. Military writes, the most disconcerting and thought-provoking book I have ever read. The Cincinnati Inquirer says it is next to impossible to read this book and not come away convinced hundreds of live POWs were abandoned in Indochina. Wichita Eagle says this book is haunting. Now, I've read portions of it this weekend, actually on Friday, and it tells of how what the reason is, why we haven't been able to get the POWs and the MIAs
back.
Why? The reason is that the CIA and the DEA have been involved in drug operations themselves internationally, and these POWs would know about it, and they don't want the story to get out. Therefore, they have obstructed Ross Perot. Here is just a sample here. Page 337. Perot makes a move. Perot was receiving a lot of information like Ann's from the families of the missing. He had always been careful to protect such information, even when pressed to reveal it by people like Congressman Solars. Events would now prove that his prudence had been wise. Relations between Bush and Perot had gone downhill ever since the vice president had asked Ross Perot how his POW/MIA investigations were going. Well, George, I go in looking for prisoners, said Perot, but I spend all my time discovering the government has been moving drugs around the world and is involved in illegal arms deals. I can't get at the prisoners because of the corruption among our own covert people. This ended Perot's official access to the highly classified files as a one-man presidential investigator. Quote, I have been instructed to cease and desist, end quote, he had informed the families of missing men early in 1987. At any rate, what the government was doing was using the opium drug trade to finance covert wars. It is shrouded in such deep mystery, John, that the sources that they investigated here knew that their lives were in danger of being terminated because of exposing these things. This is a shocker of a book. Now, I just bring this in sideways here. We may come back to it later because of its connection with my source, with our source here, telling us about FEMA, which was set up by Zbigniew Zabrinsky. Kiss the Boys Goodbye relies on volumes of documents and testimony of top military and intelligence officials. That's the book we just looked at. One key resource in the book is the willing testimony of Lieutenant General Eugene F. Tighe, Jr., U.S. Air Force, former head of the Defense Intelligence Agency, and a longtime personal friend and business associate of this writer. Now, this writer is Harry Martin, who is editor of the Napa Sentinel in Napa, California.
Oh, yeah, maybe tell me about that.
He is considered to be extremely credible, and that's important for our research here. Editor's note, General Tighe was chairman of the board of directors of Martin Cosgrove Publishing Company, Incorporated, which published Defense Systems Review and Military Communications. This writer, that is Harry Martin, was the owner-publisher of that monthly defense magazine from 1983 to 1985, Defense Systems Review and Military Communications. The International magazine's main office in 1984-85 was in Napa. Tighe was also associated with Military Electronics and Military Science Technology in 1982-83. This writer was the general manager and editorial director of those two magazines. Mm. So he's really into and understands defense. The Defense Intelligence Agency oversees all military and CIA intelligence operations. This is Harry Martin. His background includes him being who's who in America. All right. Now, Harry Martin writes this about FEMA, which was set up by
Brzezinski.
And Brzezinski is a Roman Catholic.
Yeah. Figures.
Do you remember another prominent Roman Catholic who was a Knight of Malta?
William Casey.
Mm-hmm. Head of the CIA.
Right.
Well, we're discovering they have been all through our government for years now. And they were doing things.
In every administration.
They were doing things. Now, this is FEMA, the secret government. And I'm going to just read some of this material here because it's so important. Some people have referred to it as the secret government of the United States. Now, this is our very credible source who has been editor of these various defense intelligence magazines. It is not an elected body. It does not involve itself in public disclosures, and it even has a quasi-secret budget in the billions of dollars. This government organization has more power than the President of the United States or the Congress. Mm. It has the power to suspend laws, move entire populations. Now, this is what Zabrinsky set up. Arrest and detain citizens without a warrant and hold them without trial. It can seize property, food supplies, transportation systems, and can suspend the Constitution. This is FEMA. This is FEMA, the secret government of the United States, more powerful than Congress and the President, set up by Zbigniew Brzezinski. So what we have going in this nation now is two governments.
Since the Carter administration, huh?
Yes. Set up by a Roman Catholic. And now this is going to assume great significance shortly. We are going to see the import and implications of this. Because this is more powerful. This can even suspend the Constitution. Not only is it the most powerful entity in the United States, but it was not even created under constitutional law by the Congress. What better way can Rome take over this nation than by creating an alternative government, which is more powerful than the existing government, which remains secret until the time comes for Rome to strike in this nation and seize control overnight in this nation? Suspend the Constitution?
That's the new theology, Bob. The parallel here is incredible. This is what's happened in our structure. The new theology adherents have been saying for years that we are going to work within
the structure. Yeah.
We are going to come up within the ranks.
That's right.
We are going to become the conference presidents. We are going to become the treasurers and the ministerial secretaries. We are going to become the pastors. We are going to become the church leaders. And we are going to take over the structure from within.
That's
and
right.
This structure will become the new theology. And that's exactly what has happened. Seize the moment. And it's exactly what has happened in the corporate structure of our denomination is exactly what's happened in the government and vice versa.
The parallels are so stunning, John.
Amazing. I mean, just as you were reciting, I said, this is what's happened in the structure.
Our researcher, Craig, was looking at some documentation that came in from a person that had written, and let me just get this documentation here. This came in from a person who had written to the government and had asked some questions about the Second Amendment.
Of our Constitution.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And we're going to be looking at that in detail because that's a very important part of the New World Order takeover. And he received a letter back from the government official. Now this man was very concerned because once the arms are gone from the American population, that was the one defense that the founding fathers felt
Absolutely.
That this nation had against a tyranny. The ultimate thing would come to recourse to arms, and if that ever happened, they wanted the population to have more power than the government.
As terrible as this gun situation has become in America, it is still the only thing between us and a totalitarian state.
Yeah. And so they know they have to remove the guns.
That's right.
So to disarm the population, just like Hitler did.
Yeah.
And we're going to be looking at that in a little more detail shortly when we do a close-up on that. But they know they have to disarm the population. And then they will be like sheep to the slaughter. And
That's
they
right.
can move them around. They can do whatever they want without resistance. But just to give you a sample, this is from the FBI, a letter back from the FBI, and our researcher Craig noted this, that this sounded so much like the letters that people get back from the conference office. Dear Mr. and Mrs. Ellison, your letter to Director Free regarding the regulation of firearms has been referred to me. We would like to thank you for writing on this important issue.
Yes,
the FBI strives to maintain the trust and confidence of the American public, as our success in fulfilling our mission depends upon the support and cooperation of the people we serve. Earlier this year, the FBI formed a working group of FBI officials to study issues relating to firearms violence. The increasing level of firearms-related violence directed against both law enforcement officers and our society in general has been of long-standing concern to the FBI. The working group studied many topics and issues all related directly to the safety of law enforcement officers. The group's recommendations were submitted to then-Director Sessions. He transmitted these recommendations to the Attorney General for her consideration. Without the FBI's authority, a copy of the memorandum was publicized and has since become the subject of public discussion. It did not establish an FBI public policy on gun control, nor has the FBI taken a public position regarding gun control. We appreciate your views and hope this information is helpful. Sincerely yours, Michael F. Knapp, Inspector Deputy Chief, Office of Public and Congressional Affairs.
So somebody let the cat out of the bag and they don't quite know what to do about it.
So anyway, it's a letter to
that's
try to
very typical too.
Try to disarm the person, make him not feel bad. And here we have a joint resolution in Congress right now for the repeal of the Second Amendment. In fact, let me get that right now so I don't lose it on this
tape. I can't help but thinking of all the times that the cat has got out of the bag with things that the structure has done. We have found out about it, brought it to the people's attention. They've written to their conference leaders, and they get back a letter just exactly like that.
Here is House Joint Resolution 81, proposing an amendment to the Constitution of the United States repealing the Second Amendment to the Constitution. Mm-hmm. Now, John, we have been told in fifth volume of the Testimonies that every Republican and Protestant principle of our Constitution will one day be repudiated. This is the boldest move yet to call for the repeal of one of
the Second Amendment. Unbelievable.
In fact, that amendment, that the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed, has been noted by courts as being an absolute amendment, that it refers not only to the federal government, but to the states and every other agency that has anything to do with an American citizen, that right is not to be infringed at all.
Do you know what that letter from the government is saying? Exactly what we hear as Adventists. We know that this is a change of the fundamental structure, the platform, doctrines that we have believed, but trust us.
Yeah.
You know, trust us. We need to do this and just go back to sleep. We're taking care of you and we know what we're doing and just trust us. That's exactly the snake oil our people are getting.
That's right. But I'll read this resolution now. Joint resolution. Proposing an amendment to the Constitution of the United States repealing the Second Amendment to the Constitution. Resolved by the Senate and House of Representatives of the United States of America in Congress assembled, 2/3 of each House concurring therein, that the following article is proposed as an amendment to the Constitution of the United States, which shall be valid for all intents and purposes as part of the Constitution when ratified by the legislatures of 3/4 of the several states within 7 years after the date of its submission for ratification. Here is the article. The second article of amendment to the Constitution of the United States is repealed. That is the most direct drive.
They are just coming right out about it, that they are going to change the Constitution.
Well, I think maybe I do need to say something else here.
And
that is this,
Bob.
John. We have...
I don't see how you keep all this together. I mean, God has given you special... And you know, you're not, folks, he's not going from any notes or anything. I mean, this is right out of his head. And how you could put all this together, God has given you a real ability to do this, Bob.
Well,
I don't see how you can
doing.
Do it. Praise his
Here
name.
Here I have The History of the Inquisition of Spain by Henry Charles Lee, who is a Quaker. It is the definitive work on this subject. I mean, unquestionably. And there is a whole chapter here on bearing arms. Most interesting. During the Spanish Inquisition, the inquisitors were allowed to bear arms, and their familiars, the people that accompanied them, to enforce the Inquisition, but the people were not allowed to bear arms. Mm. Therefore, the people were at their mercy.
Sure.
This is a Catholic concept of weapons control.
Absolute sheep to the slaughter.
Absolute control. A whole chapter on this subject, and the people were vulnerable. They were helpless. And then, in this book, go ahead, John.
That's the reason that in 1995 that the General Conference session is going to attempt to take the power to disfellowship away from the local church because they've got to take the control out of the people's hands and they have got to have absolute control to where the conference can come in and disfellowship people in the local church and that the disfellowshipping is taken out of the hands of the local church and put in the hands of the conference. And they're trying to get that through the 1995 General Conference session. This is the same concept. Yeah. It's a Catholic.
Disarm the people.
Disarm
make
the people.
Helpless. Make them helpless. A mass a herd that can be controlled.
That's right.
This book is That Every Man Be Armed. It's a book on the Second Amendment, because that was, I think, a quote from Patrick Henry, if I recall, The Evolution of a Constitutional Right by Stephen P. Holbrook. And he has a chapter here entitled The Common Law of England. And he describes in here how the Catholics tried to keep the Protestants disarmed legally, and the struggle in England for being able to protect one's rights and to protect oneself, and the Catholic threat to remove that ability from the Protestants. And this is why, when the framers of our Constitution wrote the Bill of Rights, they included it. They did not want any tyranny in this nation at all, whether civil or ecclesiastical, and they knew that ultimately the people might have to come to recourse of arms against the government to preserve their liberty. Now, I would say that in the context and setting of our first statement here today, John, and that is that we, as Seventh-day Adventists, know from the Bible that our weapons are not carnal, but
Amen.
They are spiritual.
We need to make that
and
very clear.
And we have angelic protection. But we are discussing the signs of the
yes.
times and the historical context and developments of certain things that have happened. Now back to FEMA.
Okay.
FEMA, which was established by the Catholic Marxist Brzezinski,
yes.
who says that the papacy is in harmony with pure Marxism, and it was accepted at Vatican II. Not only is it the most powerful entity in the United States, that's FEMA, but it was not even created under constitutional law by the Congress. It was a product of a presidential executive order. No, it is not the U.S. military nor the Central Intelligence Agency. They are subject to Congress. The organization is called FEMA, which stands for the Federal Emergency Management Agency.
You mean Jimmy Carter himself is the one who ordered this?
Executive order. Yes, but it was created and developed and designed by Brzezinski, but Carter had to sign it as an executive order.
So big ear-to-ear, chessy cat grinning Jimmy Carter, that looked so innocent as a Southern Baptist Sunday school teacher, was the one who orchestrated this thing and ordered it.
Part of it. Listen to this, next sentence. Originally conceived in the Richard Nixon administration, it was refined by President Jimmy Carter and given teeth in the Ronald Reagan and George Bush administrations.
Really?
So it's been an evolving thing, but it was the creation of the Catholic Marxist
So it's Zabrinsky. Not a Democrat-Republican thing. They're all together in
They're
this thing.
They're all together.
They're all
John,
together.
And that's a very important
yeah.
point. Both political parties appear to be fighting to
oh,
the American
yeah.
public, but their goal is the same.
They're all together.
George Bush was skull and bones, you know, secret society, New World Order. You have Clinton, Jesuit trained. You had Jerry Brown, who is running for president, Jesuit trained at the same school as Clinton. You have Patrick Buchanan, who is a Jesuit and who is now calling for a Catholic America and holding seminars on how to create a Catholic America. What if he had become president? You know, whether one or the other does, it's all the same thing.
I'm going to bring out another analogy here, and I hope I don't get hung at sunrise for it. But this is exactly the way it looks between the corporate structure and some independent ministries.
Yes, yes.
It looks like they're fighting tooth and nail, but they're really together.
Yeah. In the final analysis.
In the final analysis, they're really together against the true and faithful.
That's right.
And it looks like that there are certain independent ministries and the corporate structure who are fighting tooth and nail, but they're really together
yeah.
against the true and
That's
faithful.
Right. And there's nobody that the structure loves to use more than an apostate independent ministry.
Ooh.
Isn't that right?
Yes.
You've seen it.
Boy, I tell you, that's...
FEMA had one original concept when it was created to assure the survivability of the United States government in the event of a nuclear attack on this nation. It was also provided with the task of being...
I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
I've got to just clarify apostate independent ministry. Now the definition of an apostate independent ministry is an independent ministry that used to be part of the true and faithful.
Yeah, which has turned from it.
Which has turned from it and now gone back to the mother church.
To the structure.
Yeah. That's an apostate independent yeah. ministry. And there is nothing that can be better used by the corporate structure for the true and faithful independent ministries than to use a independent ministry who has apostatized and gone back to
absolutely.
The structure.
Absolutely. That's always been the case. Always been the case.
Man.
FEMA was also provided with the task of being a federal coordinating body during times of domestic disasters such as earthquakes, floods, and hurricanes. Its awesome powers grow under the tutelage of people like Lieutenant Colonel Oliver North and General Richard Secord, the architects on the Iran-Contra scandal, and the looting of America's savings and loan institutions. FEMA has even been given control of the State Defense Forces, a ragtag, often considered neo-Nazi civilian army that will substitute for the National Guard if the Guard is called to duty overseas. Now they're talking about taking the National Guard for duty overseas. Now this is all part of the New World Order plan. The New World Order plan calls for all of the militaries of the nation to be scaled down while the UN forces are built up. And we have all these calls for a standing UN army now, even by Reagan and prominent people all over, and that foreigners will be brought into each country, including the United States. And wait till you see the information we uncovered here, because we have troops from Russia, from Germany, of the Gurkhas, of the Belgians and Netherlands on our soil now as UN forces. Why does the UN want to bring foreign troops from another country into a different country to control that country for the New World Order? Because if we had American troops, they might have reservations about firing on American citizens.
They wouldn't fire on Americans. That, you know.
Well, they may.
But it would be a lot harder.
And there might be a struggle and a rebellion, you see.
But you bring in foreign troops, and they would have no problem firing on
Americans. They're mercenaries.
So what you're saying is that this UN coalition, and you know everything, it started with George Bush, everything is the UN now.
Yes.
UN, UN,
yes.
UN. And this thing with the UN bringing UN troops into America and having foreign troops in America so that when the New World Order takes over, they will fire on American people without reservation.
That's right.
To where they're worried that maybe if they had, that American troops wouldn't fire on their own people. We saw that in Russia recently.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
The hesitancy of the Russian troops to fire on their own people. This has always been true.
While you're talking about that, you know, the thing I always struggle with in these videos, John, is when a thought comes to my mind, I better do it.
Seize the moment, Bob.
Okay, I'll seize the moment.
Seize the moment.
I want
we'll
to bring,
just
you, bring you something here about what happened in Russia.
Bob asked today how long this video was going to be, and I said, Bob, that's how long the video is going to be, so we're just going to keep the cameras rolling. We got a whole box of master tape, and we'll just keep popping them in there as long as you've got information to give us. Now, editing this all together, now that's going to be another story. Pray for us on this.
Do you know that how did Yeltsin eventually deal with the people in the White House Parliament building in Russia?
Oh, it fired on them. Almost burned the place down.
Fired on them, burned up the top six stories. And immediately Rush Limbaugh says the next day, he says, where's he getting his clues from? I mean, it looks like a WACO WACO technique all over again.
Yeah.
Here I have a news item from The Macon Telegraph, Saturday, October 2, 1993. Yeltsin blares music to end hardliner resistance.
Where have we seen that?
Well, we saw it at
WACO.
We saw it at WACO. We saw it in Panama. We saw it in Iraq. See, psychological warfare is getting to be a big thing. And
sure.
Here's what it says. Pledging not to resort to force, you saw how long that lasted. President Boris Yeltsin's government borrowed a U.S. siege tactic on Friday and blasted high-decibel rock and rap music at defiant hardliners barricaded inside Parliament. The lawmakers answered the pounding of dire straits overlaid with Russian rap lyrics by pumping out tapes of droning speeches on privatization. The loudspeaker war came on the 11th day of the standoff between Yeltsin and the foes of his reforms and followed the failure of church-mediated efforts to negotiate an end to the crisis.
Church-mediated.
This is most interesting, John, because I just got a book by a professor from a university in Canada who has been writing books on the New World Order, and he has a poem in there that indicates that he believes that Yeltsin is a CIA agent who is getting his orders from the Vatican. I'm just throwing that in here. I'm just saying this is an intelligence man who's been with the British intelligence for 31 years, who is also a literature professor, but who has been deeply into the stuff. This is his assessment. All right, we will we'll now go to this FEMA article again here.
Okay.
These state defense forces, incidentally, John, are that are referred to here are the state militia forces. And so FEMA has even control over the militia, which was designed to be a counterpoise to the government.
Now, what brings all this into power? What brings FEMA into power? What is it?
Executive orders. And we're going to look. Oh, the sign of a presidential pen declaring that we have a national emergency.
So some catastrophic event we've been talking about for years. I preached a sermon several years ago called a global Sunday law scenario. Some global or some local catastrophe starting here in America, if need be.
Let me give you an example, John. A few weeks ago, I flipped on the evening news, I think it was a Thursday evening on NBC. The lead story was an absolutely shocking story. It was a story that in the Beqa Valley in Lebanon, there are presses running day and night producing $100 bills.
$2 billion worth, I think.
Billions of dollars worth. Now, did you hear that?
Oh, Bob, I mentioned it to my church the next Sabbath. I couldn't believe it.
But did you see it anywhere else in the news?
No.
All right, there was that
one time.
And
that was it.
And they said on the news, they brought an expert on, and he said the government is in a state of near panic over
this.
This is threatening national security. And I thought, surely, tomorrow I'm going to find out more on the news.
Nothing.
I'm going to find more in the papers. I want to get more on this story. It was hushed up just like that.
Immediately.
Why? I think they're biding their time. They will use this when the hour comes to pull the news. There will be one of many things that will they'll just say, look, things have gotten out of hand.
Exactly the thought in my head. I said, Diane, this is what it's going to be. They're going to say, they're going to change the money overnight. We're going to go to a plastic currency or change the financial structure of the world overnight. Yeah. It's going to be because of this currency, this fraudulent currency that is on the in this world now. We've got to change the dollar bill. We've got to change the method of exchange.
Yeah, those $100 bills are so perfect that the only defect on them is on the backside, a little imperfection in the L, and they blew it way up, and you could hardly see it then.
Unbelievable.
And for all practical purposes, they are perfect.
Unbelievable.
And so you see this, and let me give you another example of how we are coming to the brink. Someone's reining it in, waiting for a larger moment. A week ago, the mayor of Washington, D.C. called for the National Guard troops to be brought in to police the city streets. 500 she wanted. It had to be okayed since it was the District of Columbia by the president, by the Pentagon, and various other entities. The president said no at this point. I think they're waiting for the time when they can do it across the nation. If they do it prematurely, a reaction might set in. But you see, the L.A. riots, we now know, and I'm going to get into this in a little bit with another document. The L.A. riots were created. They were planned. Communist revolutionary organizations were brought in there to stir up the population to riot. And so the people would then plead for the troops to come in. Why don't you send in the troops? So they send in 2,000 Marines, they send in FinCEN forces, they send in various forces. And the people say, oh, wonderful, at least now we've got security. But they've given up their liberty once again to have their streets occupied by troops. And so, you know, people were shocked that the nation's capital might have military troops on its streets. But you know what the news did? They called in the police chief of Sumter, South Carolina, and he told of what a wonderful experience they had had with using the National Guard on their streets, how the people loved it and how wonderful it was. Then they called on...
This was during the hurricane they had there several years ago, or...?
No, it's just a plan that they brought in over a year's time.
Oh, I see.
To just use the National Guard to police their streets.
Okay.
And so they brought him on first, telling how wonderful the thing was, how their crime rate was down and everything. Then they bring on the head of the National Fraternal Order of Police. And he looks kind of shifty-eyed, and he won't look at the camera, and he kind of says a few things about it. He doesn't think it's good to bring out the National Guard. That should only happen in an emergency. And then they go back to the first guy, and he's just smiling and he's got all the answers. He's the pilot program. See, they use pilot programs. They put a pilot program and then they can show statistics that this worked here, and then they can impose it on the nation. I'm watching that development take place too. And they come back to him and he says, oh, the people love it. There's no problem with it. The people love it. People love to be occupied by troops on the street corners? Anyway, this I think also is being reined in for a time down the line when the hour comes. The most powerful organization in the United States, back to FEMA, though it may be the most powerful organization in the United States, few people know it even exists, but it has crept into our private lives. Even mortgage papers contain FEMA's name in small print if the property in question is near a floodplain. FEMA was deeply involved in the Los Angeles riots and the 1989 Loma Prieta earthquake in the San Francisco Bay Area. Some of the black helicopter traffic reported throughout the United States, but mainly in the West, California, Washington, Arizona, New Mexico, Texas, and Colorado are flown by FEMA personnel. Now, what's happening with this, John, is, and we'll look at it more in another document that we have here, a counterintelligence military report. These black helicopters are the helicopters being used by the United Nations personnel, FinCEN forces, FEMA forces, MJTF police forces, and we'll look at what all those are shortly. They have no insignias on them. The personnel operating them have no insignias. They are all dressed in black. We have gotten reports at our ministry. We got a report from Battle Creek, Michigan, that there were these black people with no insignias on the streets they had seen there. There are reports out of Michigan, in certain areas of Michigan, of seeing these black helicopters. They're Chinooks. 40 to 50 of them across the sky from one horizon to the other in waves going across the sky. No United States Air Force insignias. They're UN helicopters. Now they have a purpose, and we're going to be looking at that shortly, a diabolical purpose to perform.
UN forces, helicopters?
UN.
That are being brought into the United States?
That are operating in the United States. All black. See, there have been these sightings all over here, California, Washington, Arizona, New Mexico, Texas, Colorado. Sightings all over the nation. Michigan, too. What are these black helicopters? No, people couldn't figure it out for a long time, and now we know that they are FEMA. They are FinCEN, which is a UN force. These are 3,000 Chinook helicopters that were taken out of mothballs in 1989. We'll be looking at it in detail in another document. For a diabolical purpose, ultimately, in this nation, in accordance with the FEMA laws. Each one of those helicopters, incidentally, can hold 64 people.
64?
64 heavy lift helicopters. They're the ones with the big rotors front and back, Chinooks.
Wow.
FEMA has been given responsibility for many new disasters, including urban forest fires, home heating emergencies, refugee situations, urban riots, and emergency planning for nuclear and toxic incidents. In the West, it works in conjunction with the Sixth Army. FEMA was created by a series of executive orders. A presidential executive order, whether constitutional or not, becomes law simply by its publication in the Federal Registry.
Our people need to understand that.
Congress is bypassed.
Yes.
Executive Order number 12148 created the Emergency Management Agency that is to interface with the Department of Defense for civil defense planning and funding. An emergency czar was appointed. FEMA has only spent about 6% of its budget on national emergencies. The bulk of their funding has been used for the construction of secret underground facilities to assure continuity of government in case of a major emergency, foreign or domestic. And you can see those as you come up through Virginia and approach near Washington, D.C. I've seen some of those mountains where they have these underground areas. Executive Order number 12656 appointed the National Security Council as the principal body that should consider emergency powers. This allows the government to increase domestic intelligence and surveillance of U.S. citizens and would restrict the freedom of movement within the United States and grant the government the right to isolate large groups of civilians. Now we're talking about isolating large groups of civilians. The National Guard could be federalized to seal all borders. You think you're going to get out of the United States when that hour comes? And take control of U.S. airspace and all ports of entry. Here are just a few executive orders associated with FEMA that would suspend the Constitution and the Bill of Rights. These executive orders have been on record for nearly 30 years and could be enacted by the stroke of a presidential pen. Executive Order 10990 allows the government to take over all modes of transportation and control of highways and seaports.
Now, our people need to understand that an executive order means that he bypasses Congress.
Bypasses Congress.
All it takes is a stroke of his pen.
That's right. Notice, this one allows the government to take over all modes of transportation, air, land, sea, and control of highways and seaports. And those who have studied this very carefully say that when the crackdown comes, when the seizure of power finally takes place, one of the first things that will happen will be the closure of all of the interstate highway systems. You won't be able to move. Do you know, John, I must say something here, and that is something about this book, Country Living. This is a book that Ellen White, it's a compilation of her writings about getting ready for this crisis. Remember this book?
Oh, yes.
Wonderful book. And I want to read just a quote here. Few realize the importance of shunning, so far as possible, all associations unfriendly to religious life. In choosing their surroundings, few make their spiritual prosperity the first consideration. I remember you telling me, John, how wonderful it is to have a home to come to where there's peace and security.
A sanctuary.
A sanctuary. Better sacrifice any and every worldly consideration than to imperil the precious souls committed to your care.
Amen.
They will be assailed by temptations and should be taught to meet them, but it is your duty to cut off every influence, to break up every habit, to sunder every tie that keeps you from the most free, open, and hearty committal of yourselves and your family to God. Instead of the crowded city, seek some retired situation where your children will be, so far as possible, shielded from temptation, mm-hmm. and there train and educate them for usefulness. Anyway, mm-hmm. in this book, she tells of how we are to have our homes out in the country, away from the cities. And as this tape goes on, you will see, John, we are still only laying a groundwork here. The diabolical dimensions of this will emerge as we go along. But you will see how wonderfully blessed those people will be who have a home in the country, away from a municipality, away from the cities, because when the crackdown comes, you won't be able to move.
You know,
all movement of the civilian population will be blocked.
Even going to Orlando, you know, is just a very high-stress situation, having to go into Orlando. And as we come out of Orlando, and we come through Apopka, and then we come through Zellwood,
yeah.
and then we come to Mount Dora.
That's right.
And you just, you know, the stress level That's just right. starts going down. You start seeing pastures instead of stores, and pretty soon you start seeing trees
and lakes
and open fields, and the stress level just starts coming in. Pretty soon you start seeing cattle, and it's just the most wonderful feeling coming out of that stressful. Mm-hmm. And you can see why our prophet said that. And if she said that 100 years ago, just imagine what it is now.
From many dimensions, John, because when people are in a high-stress environment continually, they're much more controllable and manageable. Yeah. They're overloaded with stimuli, and they're ready. If the police say, go this way, they do this, do that, you go through all of the counters and on the highways and put your money in, and you're used to just being part of the herd. Whereas when you're out in the country, much more individuality develops, like in the early days of our country. The time is fast coming when the controlling power of the labor unions, this is page 9 of Country Living, will be very oppressive. Again and again, the Lord has instructed that our people are to take their families away from the cities into the country, where they can raise their own provisions. For in the future, the problem of buying and selling will be a very serious one. We should now begin to heed the instruction given us over and over again. Get out of the cities into rural districts where the houses are not crowded closely together and where you will be free from the interference of enemies.
Amen.
We must be preparing for these issues. And that, of course, is the thrust of this whole book. Before the overflowing scourge shall come upon the dwellers of the earth, the Lord calls upon all who are Israelites indeed to prepare for that event.
Bob, just the other night, the first night that you and your family were here from South Dakota, we invited you over to our home to share our evening meal with us. And you know, we live 20 miles on beyond Mount Dora from the ministry, and we have to drive back and forth 20 miles to get to work every morning and to go home in the evening, but it's worth it.
Oh, yeah.
Because I tell you, to be able to get away from, and the closer you get out, the more you feel the spiritual and the peace.
That's right.
And you have to have that sanctuary, even though we are to be, some of us have been called to be on the outskirts of the cities and to work the city, so to speak. When you go home, have that place, according to the council, out, you know, a sanctuary away from the hubbub of the city, and what a blessing it is.
That's right. And here is another very interesting quotation. Do not consider it a great deprivation that you must go into the hills and mountains, but seek for that retirement where you can be alone with God.
Amen.
To learn His will and way.
It's so important.
Again and again, these kind of statements, if the land is cultivated, it will, with the blessing of God, supply our necessities. We're heading into a time when we won't be able to buy food. It is the ultimate weapon of control of the New World Order. And God's people have been counseled to be able to buy their own food. And she says, of the early strong men cut off to a great degree from contact with and dependence upon men, and separated from the world's corrupting maxims and customs and excitements, they would come nearer to the heart of nature. God's presence would be more real to them. Many would learn the lesson of dependence upon Him. Through nature, they would hear His voice speaking to their hearts of His peace and love, and mind and soul and body would respond to the healing, life-giving power.
Bob, all it's going to take to bring anarchy in this country is for the 18-wheelers to stop rolling.
Oh, absolutely, John.
When the 18-wheelers stop rolling, this nation is coming to its knees. There is not going to be food on the shelves of the stores. There's not going to be gasoline. There's not going to be any articles of anything in any of the stores. That's when roving bands of citizens will be roaming the streets
looking for food. Yeah.
Oh, and that can come so quickly, Bob.
That's right.
That could come in a matter of days.
It could come overnight.
Well, you know what happens in Florida here, whenever we get word that a hurricane is something, man, you go to the stores and the shelves are bare. People go in and they're just cleaning off the shelves, and they're stuffing the stuff in their carts, and they're fighting and scrapping in the aisles of the store. It's terrible here before any type of a storm comes, what takes place, and everybody's fighting over batteries and food, and you go in the, and if you're a couple hours late, you go in the grocery stores and the shelves are bare.
They're gone.
Absolutely.
Just a note here about FinCEN. I mentioned it here, and I have a little sheet here on what FinCEN is, and I mentioned that it was connected with the UN, and my understanding from an intelligence report is that it is at least in the service of the UN, as many of these agencies will be, but I want to clarify this a little bit by reading this page about what is FinCEN. FinCEN is the Financial Crime Enforcement Network. As a part of the trust to monitor and control the American people, the Bush administration has established the Financial Crime Center, FinCEN, in Arlington, Virginia, whereby through the use of sophisticated computers, the government has combined more than 100 databases on bank records, criminal suspects, driving records, census data, and myriads of business and financial activities of millions of honest, law-abiding citizens. FinCEN is the largest government-run artificial intelligence database ever established. FinCEN has over 200 employees from the IRS, the FBI, the Secret Service, and the FDIC, and works closely with the BATF, the CIA, and the Defense Intelligence Agency. FinCEN acts as a collection point, clearing, and distribution center of computerized data for virtually all other government agencies. Data which it receives and redistributes comes from bank deposits, Fed bank reports, Comptroller of the Currency reports, FDIC bank reports, census income figures, customs monetary reports, and FBI and DEA drug data. FinCEN currently has access to over 35 financial databases, and they will create another 100, including computerized land records, real estate records, credit reports, CTRs, Form 8300, bank reports, etc. Now, you see, if you own real estate, if you deal with a bank, you're information is there with
Vincent. Absolutely. They know more about you than you know about yourself.
That's right.
It's unbelievable. And much of it is, most of it is on that little magnetic strip on the back of your credit card. I mean, yeah. The information that is available on each and every one of us would just, it would just amaze us if we knew the information that was together on each one of us.
That's right. The models, data, financial patterns, and individual names generated by FinCEN are being shared with the IRS, its Criminal Investigation Division, and state and local governments. Before a recent amendment to the Right to Financial Privacy Act passed, these activities were illegal. But notice, here is a recent amendment to the Right to Financial Privacy Act was passed. And before that, these activities were illegal. Now they're legal. Were you aware that was passed?
No.
How many people knew about it?
Did not know it.
By the way, let me tell you something, John. Tens of thousands of laws and regulations are being passed every year that the citizen knows nothing about. And I understand that the head of the IRS, I think it was 20 years ago, said that there are so many rules with the IRS that everybody's in violation of some rule. And so anybody can be mad.
They want to get you, sure.
Virtually all the activities of FinCEN violate the U.S. Constitution's Fourth Amendment guarantee of the right to privacy. FinCEN and U.S. government officials admit that FinCEN is a trial run for a world system of financial tracking, surveillance, and control.
Admit
FinCEN is an essential element of George Bush's and Mikhail Gorbachev's New World Order and of the coming New Age. So that's FinCEN.
Wow.
Now back to FEMA.
Okay.
We got a bunch more executive orders here.
Okay.
Executive Order 10995 allows the government to seize and control the communication media.
Now, this is already in effect.
This isn't something future. It's an executive order already for 30 years.
It's already in place. Right, already in place.
All right. So there go your TV stations, your radio stations, Caleb and Joshua, ham radios, the whole works. Executive Order 10997 allows the government to take over all electric power, gas, petroleum, fuels, and minerals. All right, the gas station's now under the control of FEMA and the FEMA government. Executive Order 10998 allows the government to take over all food resources and farms. You own a farm? Take it over. Food resources, all the distribution centers for the food, trucking of it, and all of that. Executive Order 11000 allows the government to mobilize civilians into work brigades under government supervision. How would you like to be out in a work brigade on the road all of a sudden? Executive Order 11001 allows the government to take over all health, education, and welfare functions. All health, education, and welfare functions. Executive Order 11002 designates the Postmaster General to operate a national registration of all persons. Register everybody. Executive Order 11003 allows the government to take over all airports and aircraft, including commercial aircraft. Executive Order 11004 allows the Housing and Finance Authority to relocate communities. By the way, do you remember about Hitler relocating communities? Relocating the Jews, and where did they wind up?
Warsaw Ghetto.
And they also wound up in Auschwitz. Yes. Build new housing with public funds, designate areas to be abandoned. Sorry, Chicago is going to be abandoned. And establish new locations for populations. Look at this. Moving whole populations with the stroke of a pen, an executive order bypassing Congress.
Treblinka.
Yes. Executive Order 11051 specifies the responsibility of the Office of Emergency Planning and gives authorization to put all executive orders into effect in times of increased international tensions and economic or financial crisis. Now, we just talked about a financial crisis a few minutes ago. Executive Order 110310 grants authority to the Department of Justice to enforce the plans set out in executive orders to institute industrial support, to establish judicial and legislative liaison to control all aliens, to operate penal and correctional institutions, and to advise and assist the president. Executive Order 11049 assigns emergency preparedness function to federal departments and agencies, consolidating 21 operative executive orders issued over a 15-year period. Executive Order 11921 allows the Federal Emergency Preparedness Agency to develop plans to establish control over the mechanisms of production and distribution of energy sources, wages, salaries, credit, and the flow of money in the U.S. financial institution in any undefined national emergency. It also provides that when a state of emergency is declared by the president, Congress cannot review the action for 6 months. So if the president declares a state of emergency, Congress cannot review the action for 6 months.
By that time, the nation could have been destroyed.
Yes. The Federal Emergency Management Agency has broad powers in every aspect of the nation. General Frank Salcedo, chief of FEMA's Civil Security Division, stated in a 1983 conference that he saw FEMA's role as a, quote, new frontier in the protection of individual and government leaders from assassination and of civil and military installations from sabotage and or attack, as well as prevention of dissident groups from gaining access to U.S. opinion or a global audience in times of crisis. Notice that, dissident groups gaining access to U.S. opinion.
Whoa.
That will be blocked by FEMA.
Mm-hmm.
What might be a dissident group wanting access to U.S. opinion? What might be considered?
I don't know if I should even comment on that. I think I'm just going to let that one cook for a couple of minutes.
Okay. FEMA's powers were consolidated by President Carter to incorporate the National Security Act of 1947, which allows for the strategic relocation of industries, services, government, and other essential economic activities, and to rationalize the requirements for manpower, resources, and production facilities. The 1950 Defense Production Act, which gives the president sweeping powers over all aspects of the economy. The Act of August 29, 1916, which authorizes the Secretary of the Army in time of war to take possession of any transportation system for transporting troops, material, or any other purpose related to the emergency, and the International Emergency Economic Powers Act, which enables the president to seize the property of a foreign country or national. These powers were transferred to FEMA in a sweeping consolidation in 1979.
Wow.
Well, there's a lot more here about how Hurricane Andrew focused attention on FEMA. But we want to now look at another very important document, John, and this is the one I suppose that shook me up as much as anything. It is a document by a man named Mark Kornke. This man was a intelligence analyst from 1975 to 1981, initially with USIC's Company D out of Arizona. And from there he moved on to the 5th U.S. Army Intelligence Center, where he worked both as an intelligence analyst and a counterintelligence coordinator. He also worked for NASA from 75 to 77. And through the 1980s, he has commanded 2 Outfor brigades, which are special warfare units that train in foreign warfare and tactics. Now this Mark Kornke is a most unusual man. He obviously has a Christian orientation with his thinking process. He is deeply patriotic, and he is a man who believes in the Constitution. I will say this about him. He belongs to what is called the Patriot Movement here in America. Now, I don't know how many people in the average run of society understand about this movement, but they are a movement that is watching closely the developments of the New World Order and are deeply concerned that it means the elimination of freedom in America, and they are committed to defending the Constitution.
Could you equate that to the True and Faithful Independent Ministries?
Well, there's certain problems there, though, because the Patriot organizations believe in using military force to block the New World Order.
Okay.
And they are very optimistic about their capability of doing this ultimately. They are making all kinds of preparation, and they are being very closely watched by the New World Order
people,
as you can imagine.
I'm sure.
In fact, Mark Kornke here has been interrogated by the FBI about 3 times. They're after him. And
sure.
A friend of his was conducted in an airbase to a back room on the southwest corner of the air base, where there was an individual all in black indicating this UN orientation. He was taken into an interrogation room and interrogated all about his family, you know, whether he had any weapons and all of this type of thing. And then the interrogators left the room, but they left a classified document within reach of him, knowing that he would pick it up and look at it. So he looked at it, and here was a list of people that they were wanting to arrest, and Mark Kornke was at the top, the most wanted man in Michigan. Now, this man has a real grasp. He's a military analyst. He is a counterintelligence coordinator, and he has carried on his intelligence gathering capabilities to expose the New World Order. He is deeply concerned about all of this. He understands about FEMA. He understands about FinCEN, about various forces and the plans that are being laid. He has obvious access to sources that the average person doesn't have because of his background. I shall begin by discussing the MJTF police. Now, have you ever heard of them, John?
The MJTF, no.
Okay.
I was trying to figure it out when you said those letters earlier.
The Multi-Jurisdictional Task Force Police. Where it came from, he's going to discuss now, and what its original mission was and what its mission is now. In approximately March of 1989, a sequence of political actions was initiated whereby the federal government extorted resources from most of the states, if not all 50 states, simultaneously within a two-week period, passing laws in every state authorizing the use of federal funding to convert local and state forces into national police forces. Now, we just briefly touched on the significance and meaning of a national police force. I want to touch on that again in this setting, John.
Now, you're talking about this national police force. Was that what you were referring to?
Well, about Clinton is talking about a national...
About the UN troops, or is this something different?
Okay, this is... you'll see how it fits in with the UN and the New World Order gradually. The multi-jurisdictional task force is a force that was created in 1989, simultaneously in all the states, linking federal, state, and local police forces, and another entity, which we'll be looking at briefly, to do a certain job for FEMA and the New World Order at a certain critical juncture. But right now I want to just digress for a minute and talk about the nationalization. We're talking about a national police force being established here. And this is exactly what happened with the Gestapo. And I have here a book by Robert Gallately. I picked this up in London, The Gestapo and German Society. And the beginnings of this book are most interesting because they tell about how the police functioned in Germany and how the consolidation took place under the Gestapo, the nationalization of the police force. Now, we have open talk now by Bill Clinton about nationalized police force and national police forces, bringing the young people in who have to pay back their student loans and getting them into a program of working in a national police force. He ran on a platform of bringing 100,000 more policemen out on the streets. And so this is a very serious development. Anything that has to do with a national police force that takes it out of the hands of the local police, the local sheriff, the local, the state troopers, the other agencies which have functioned, you know, as entities in themselves. One of the most powerful men in law enforcement in the United States, incidentally, is the sheriff. The sheriff has enormous powers, but they're not exercising them when they come in conflict with federal agencies, as we see has happened in both the WACO incident and in the Randy Weaver incident. In the WACO incident, it should have been the sheriff that delivered a search warrant with a knock at the door to the people. And in the past, when the sheriff did that to the Branch Davidians, they always allowed him in. They had no problem at all.
You were telling me on Friday the difference between the BATF and the Gestapo. What was the difference?
Well, this is a little cartoon that came out in a magazine asking the question, what is the difference between the BATF and the Gestapo? And the answer is that the Gestapo had the courtesy to knock at the door, whereas what we see happening, They weren't after David, the arrest of David Koresh. If they wanted to arrest him, they could have arrested him when he was jogging. He jogged on the road.
Sure.
They could have arrested him when he went into town.
Sure.
The people all knew him. You know, I talked to Jan Markison at length about his interviews in the Waco area, and he said the people all said that he was a very well-mannered, very likable, charismatic mm-hmm. type of individual. He had the sheriff had been out to his operation there before, and there had been no problem. But this was a different thing that they were trying to accomplish when the BATF attacked with a force of scores of men screaming at the top of their voices. This was something different. We want to look at that after we have looked at all of this groundwork about the New World Order and all, because it will crystallize the developments in a very concrete and empirical way of what we've looked at in theory initially, if that's all right
sure.
with you, John. We want to look at both of those incidents because they're most significant. We have a lot of detail on them now.